Hello and welcome to everyone to this special episode of Gupshup with Gil. It's quite similar to what we had done just before the Indian women's cricket team was about to tour England and they were going to play a test match after 6 years. This time also there's another historic event in women's cricket, that is the Indian women's cricket team will be playing a day-night test match for the very first time in the history of Indian women's cricket. I have someone with me who's played cricket. She's played for Hyderabad and she's been around in the circuit for quite long. She's also written extensively on women's cricket. I have with me Ananya Upendran of Women Cricket Zone. She's the editor of that magazine. And like I've mentioned before, if there's one place where you want to study or read anything related to women's cricket, and it's not just Indian women's cricket, but all around the world, Women's Cricket Zone is the place to go. So I'll now welcome Ananya to the show. Welcome, Ananya. I hope you know it's a very insightful chat where those who watch this preview will get to know a lot more about women's cricket than what they know already. And I hope you have fun.
Yeah, well, thanks for having me, Gurkirat. It's always a pleasure to talk women's cricket. So hopefully we give the viewers some good insights ahead of this tour.
So, Ananya, what do you think should be the expectations of the fans considering how the English tour went? You know, the test match was drawn. And even though the women's team lost the ODI series and the T20 series that followed, there was still some amount of fight that was put in by the women's team and there were a few bright spots. Now, do you think that the women's team can do one better than what they did in the English tour? Or, you know, we might be in for a similar kind of result, a result considering how strong Australia is in women's cricket. People forget that they're much more stronger in women's cricket than what they might be in men's cricket.
Yeah, I mean, look, Australia are the number one side in women's cricket for a reason. They won 24 ODIs on the trot. So it's definitely going to be a tough tour for India. But having said that, I think this is probably India's best chance to beat them. Just considering the injuries amongst that Australian squad. Also, you know, the fact that Australia haven't played together as a team since March, April this year, whereas India have had game time under their belt. They had a preparatory camp in Bangalore. So they're gelling as a unit. They understand each other's strengths and weaknesses. I mean, of course, they've played together for several years now, but just that time together, I think considering all that, I think India should go into the series with a realistic chance of actually, you know, stopping that Australian juggernaut. But again, this is India we're talking about. When you pile up hopes on them, sometimes they come crashing down. But this team, I think, has shown, like they did in England, that they have some fight and you can't really count them out. So I'm definitely hoping that, you know, they go one better. But again, this is the number one team in the world. So
now, there are also three debutants who've been drafted into the squad and their names are Meghna Singh, Yastika Bhatia and Renuka Singh. What do you expect from them? I'm sure you must have studied them and covered them before they you know, been a part of the India squad. Tell us something about these three players who've been drafted now.
Well, you know, I'm really excited about Meghna Singh coming into the side. She's an exciting fast bowler. Ramesh Pawar, after that tour, said, you know, that India need tall fast bowlers who can bowl at a fair clip. And Meghna Singh is like that. She's not a tearaway quick, but she bowls at a fair clip, say 112, 115. So a good outswing bowler. And I think she's a huge weapon with the new ball. She's shown that for Indian Railways over the last couple of seasons. Been an integral part of that lineup. So I'm hoping she does make her debut because I think she'll be very, very useful in Australian conditions, has a very good bouncer as well. And Renuka Singh, on the other hand, another seam bowler, but an in-swinger, like the complete opposite of Meghna Singh. So she's, again, someone who's good with the new ball, has a fair few change-ups. But these are two players that I'm very excited about. But within the batting front, there is Yastika Bhatia, like you said. And, you know, having watched Yastika over the years, she started off as, you know, someone in the under-19 circuit who was extremely talented. Like, you could just see that she was oozing with skill, dominated the under-19 circuit for quite a few years, even captain West Zone to an interzonal title when I think she was only 17 or something. So, you know, her rise to the Indian team is probably feels inevitable. I mean, she's made for international cricket and is a high class batter. So it's wonderful to see her, you know, kind of make the jump. Hopefully she does get a few games. I mean, I think in the practice game, she got a 40 odd. So I think she will add a lot, especially considering she is a lefty. But you know, whether she will get a chance in what is quite settled Indian middle order will be a question. But I'm sure she'll take her chances with both hands if and when she gets them.
You mentioned two things over here. I'll ask, you know, firstly, I'll talk about the middle order. You mentioned the Indian middle order, but, you know, as we saw in the ODI series that was, you know, with England and then earlier this year with South Africa, there's been one genuine criticism, I feel, that has come off the women's team. And that is that sometimes that they're not able to pace their innings well enough and they've not been able to, you know, post those high scores of 250 plus, of 270, which might be the demand or which might be something that other teams might be more competent at doing, say the Australian team or the English team, and even South African team as to how they did in the series earlier in Feb or March this year. So do you think there's a scope of improvement? Because on the pace bowling front, Ramesh Pawar has quite openly said that we need more support for Julen so that she's not, you know, being restricted in her role and she's been allowed to attack. Do you think something like that might be needed in the middle order as well, with the likes of Harman and Mithali being allowed to, you know, bat a little more freely than what they are doing right now?
Oh, definitely. I mean, I think the way India go back through those middle overs has been an issue for quite a while now. And we've seen that the likes of England and Australia and even South Africa have kind of broken away where they have those power players in the middle order. Whereas I think the issue with India has been that we pack the squad with opening batters because they're always the highest run getters in domestic cricket. So, you know, you have people who've largely batted in the top three through their domestic career, you know, getting into the Indian side and then kind of having to find their way at numbers 5 and 6 or, you know, even lower than that. So I think that's where the major difference has been. I mean, you look at someone like Deepti Sharma, for example, batting at number 5 or 6 for India, goes into domestic cricket, bats opening for Bengal. So, you know, there is no practice in that situation. It happens directly in international cricket. So I think that's one of the major issues. And what I'm really, really excited about is Richa Ghosh's inclusion in this squad, in the ODI team especially, because she is someone who's done that, you know, for Bengal over the last 4 or 5 seasons, where she bats at number 5, 6. So she knows how to pace her innings. She knows how to clear the field, find the boundary, even when the field is spread. Whereas I think the opening batters kind of tend to take their time a little bit before they find their range. So just the inclusions of Richa Ghosh, Sneh Rana, hopefully I think India, you know, find that power player in that lower middle order, because like you said, that's something that we've kind of struggled with. We haven't really been able to push the pace in those last 10 overs. And I'm hoping that this tour to Australia, we're able to kind of plug that gap.
Well, you know, it's on a lighter note, I think we can say that some of the issues of both the men's and the women's cricket team is similar, because for the longest time, as someone who's followed the men's team quite closely, could say that in the T20s also a similar thing was happening. The likes of Shreyas Iyer and Manish Pandey were being picked for the number 5 and the number 4 role, when ideally they don't even bat at those positions for their franchise or their domestic side. So there's something, you know, you could say on lighter note is something, you know, that plagues both the teams. Now, there's another thing which you mentioned, that you hope to see those three new inclusions like Meghna Singh, you know, make a mark and play one of the games. But, you know, would it be right for all of us to be hopeful of that, considering there were three other players who, you know, were drafted in the squad for England, like Indrani Roy, Priya Punia and Simran Bahadur, who, you know, have now been dropped without getting a game. So how disappointing can it be for these players, and what kind of a message does it send to the prospective players or the prospective players who are looking to make the Indian side? And is it again something that raises a question mark on the selection committee, or you think it's just a phase where they are looking to try out players and then, you know, doing the chopping and changing of the few players who are on the fringe? How do you look at it?
Well, look, I mean, I think it's very, very unfortunate that the three of them got culled without getting a game, like you said, in England. I mean, to spend an entire tour on the bench, you know, having been in all three squads, especially in the case of Indrani and Priya, or sorry, Indrani, you know, to spend the entire tour on the bench and then not get a game, get culled after doing pretty well in the preparatory camp. I'm sure it's very, very disheartening. And she did speak about it, that she was very disappointed. And you know, one of the things is that we need to be very, very careful in terms of how this affects players, because this is an issue that's, you know, been part of Indian cricket, unfortunately, for a very long time, where we've had absolutely no communication between selectors and players. Forget about selectors and the media. So, you know, it's an issue that's been plaguing Indian cricket for a long time. And, you know, the only thing I think you can hope is that it doesn't, you know, lead to the end of someone's career and break a young player like Indrani or Priya, because they've obviously gotten to the top because they have plenty of skill and they've done the hard yards. So it's important that we find a way to manage these players. I mean, even if the selectors haven't had a word with them, hopefully the coaching staff have, and, you know, they let them know that these are the areas you need to improve, or these are the reasons you don't fit into the squad for now. But as far as, you know, whether people like Meghna or Yastika will get a chance, I certainly see Meghna playing, because again, she's been part of squads where Mithali Raj has led. So Mithali Raj knows exactly what she can do. And she, I know that she thinks very highly of her because she's done very well for Railways. So I'm hopeful that Meghna will make a case for herself or get a decent run. But yeah, I think, you know, wider perspective, we need to find a way to kind of manage our players a lot better.
You know, considering what happened in England with these three players, and, you know, again, the limited amount of white ball games, do you think it would have been better in terms of scheduling had, instead of the test match that is being played, the boards could have decided to play two extra ODI games, also considering how the World Cup is only, what, maybe 5 months away? Do you think that was a possibility, or, because the reason why I ask this is because outside of these three countries, there's not a lot of test matches that anyway happen in women's cricket. So as a fan who's wanting to understand, what I fail to sometimes gather is what is being achieved by playing these one-off test matches is something that I'm looking for an answer for.
Well, look, I think all the players have been very clear that they do want to play test cricket and they'd love to play, you know, get the opportunity to play more test cricket than they're getting to play right now. And I think right now it feels like for the fans or for anyone covering the game, the one-off tests in these series kind of feel like, you know, it's kind of like a placeholder. I'm for want of a better word, I can't think of the right word, but it just feels like it's there for namesake, I suppose. But again, it's a big deal for these players who are playing in it. So, you know, from their perspective, it's great that they get to play it. But I suppose the question that you're asking is, does it make more sense to play more ODIs, especially in the lead up to a World Cup? Definitely so. And I think one of the things that I was hopeful of was that, you know, maybe they continue to play a test match, but one of the things that I think they could have done is maybe, you know, had an A tour alongside the full strength or the international series, because that's something that Pakistan and West Indies did do when they played. They had an A tour alongside the international series. That's something that England are doing ahead of, alongside the Ashes. So I think that would have been something that would be interesting, because then it would allow the players who are on the bench also to get game time. It allows you to take a larger contingent. It allows you to get a clearer look at all the players. You don't have to then, you know, leave a Priya Punia or an Indrani Roy on the bench. If they don't play for India, they play for India A. You get a look at them. And everyone gets an opportunity to showcase what they're doing. So, you know, the test match is great. I would always want teams to play more multi-format series. But alongside that, I think these are things that can be done, especially considering that, you know, the squads that travel now are large, pretty large squads. You go with 22, sometimes 24 players. So you can afford to play an A series alongside the international tour. And I think that's something that India could have done.
Well, it makes sense, because like you said, it gives you, also, you know, with some amount of uncertainty of what are they going to play after the Australia tour, because as of now, their schedule for the next year isn't clear. The BCCI app and website only shows the World Cup. And what I've heard is that there are a few games that will happen in between, but the dates have not been finalized yet. So I think from that point of view, it makes complete sense to probably, you know, arrange an A tour as well. Now, from a World Cup preparation point of view, what do you feel, you know, that the team could look to achieve in these matches, considering, you know, conditions might be similar because the World Cup's also in New Zealand. I'm not sure, the ground size may not be similar because in men's field, you know, you see that the boundary dimensions are quite different. But how do you see this series, you know, helping Indian team to become better, or, you know, plug out a few holes that they might have going into the World Cup or into the lead up of the World Cup?
Well, look, there's nothing like testing yourself against the best team in the world. So I think, you know, for starters, it's just an opportunity for all the players to, one, get game time, and two, understand, you know, how you're going to do against one of the best sides in the world, a team that actually knows how to win from any situation, regardless of who's pulling on the uniform on that day. So I think India will definitely hopefully take a lot of lessons from this tour. And I think it's also just an opportunity, like, to kind of figure out who plays what role going into that World Cup, because that's been one of the things that's been very unclear with this Indian side, at least in the ODIs, has been that lower middle order, you're not quite sure who's playing what role. And I think these, or all the games leading into the World Cup, are going to be great for that, just to allow people to explore what they can do in their specific roles. And Ramesh Pawar, again, when he took over, said that, "I'm very keen to make sure that people play, you know, specific roles and they understand what needs to be done." So this just allows the team, whether it's the batters, whether it's the bowlers, to kind of figure out who's going to win you games under pressure. And again, no better place like Australia, and against the best team in the world.
Well, about to wrap this up, just one last question before we do that. Any predictions that you have from the tour, or any player who you think, you know, might do well, maybe, you know, carrying their form, or, you know, looking to prove a point? Any predictions in terms of who do well, or, you know, which team will do well, or what might happen?
Well, look, I'm really bad at making predictions, so I'm not going to make like a serious prediction. But I think someone like Smriti Mandhana.
If you don't want to make a prediction, what is it that you wish from this group as a fan?
Well, as a fan, what I wish for is for India to kind of, for the seamers to do very well. I think they've gotten a lot of flack, sometimes unfairly. And I'd really, really like for them to kind of step up and win games for India, because I think the group of seamers who have been selected are very, very good. I mean, think of someone like Pooja Vastrakar. Shikha Pandey has done it for a very long time, kind of flown under the radar, unfortunately. But Pooja, within the ODI side, it's a very solid, you know, back up to Jhulan Goswami. We keep saying that she's the only one there, but there are seamers who I think have kind of, maybe not always pulled their weight, but, you know, they are a very good group. So I'm hoping that, my wish list would be that they do very, very well. And I think also, you know, I'm keen to see what India do with their keeper, because I think Tanya Bhatia is an extremely good keeper, easily the best in India right now. But, you know, how India handle her is something I'm interested to see.
Well, on that note, we'll you know, complete this preview to the series. And like Ananya said, hoping that, you know, the fast bowlers pull their weight and we see a few good performances. I personally want to see a good performance from the middle order and the lower middle order, you know, hoping to see them rise to the occasion and not always rely on someone like a Mithali or Harman to bail them out, because that will give them a lot of confidence going into the World Cup after this series. But yes, thank you so much for joining this. And yeah, do follow the series. It is something that we all should do as a part of, you know, promoting women's cricket. And for all the detailed analysis, or, you know, scorecards or reports on women's cricket, do you know, visit the Women's Cricket Zone website. That's it from this episode. Please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Thank you so much.